Guard, I need to sing karaoke now. No, you don't. It's not happening. Hey, you owe me. Rhetoric says you need to approach this situation logically. Ask him why he has the PA system installed, if you can't use it. Johnny Law is about to tear it up. Why do you even have the PA system if no one's going to use it? It's for the... He begins confidently, but then stumbles on his own words. It's for no one. It's a prop. I'm not letting anyone use it after the great karaoke catastrophe of 44. What happened in 44? A lot of people got killed because some jerk wanted to sing karaoke. When was the last time you had a band play here? It's not for bands, it's for clients. Some clients, okay? Not you. I'm a real client, I've paid my bills, and I have the right to use the karaoke machine. Ha! Well, he comes up with a counter-argument. We don't have any tapes, they all got stolen. Jama says he's lying, but whatever, you don't really need his lame tracks. It's alright, I have my own song with me. Give him the tape for Smallest Church in St. Sains. The man in the vest and the violent shirt stares at the tape you've just given him. He begins to frown, hard. Authority says this is the look of a man who's defeated. He knows he's out of excuses. Fine, fine. Climb on that stage and do your thing. Just get out of my hair. He shakes the tape at you. I'll plug it in for you. Damn this karaoke machine. I'm not paying my bill for tonight. I'm going to stay somewhere else. At the fishing lodge. Ready, guys? We're going to do this thing. Oh, the people are here. Well, we'll give them a little show and then we'll talk to them. There's all kinds of people here that we can talk to. Hate to break it to you, Gary, but those rhinos don't just combust into flames. Alright, I'm zooming in for our big debut. Should I put this stuff away? The stage is all set up for your performance. Feels silent. You can hear the pellets crack under your feet. Pellets? Savoir Faire says, you feel a little dizzy, a little unsteady suddenly. So, are you ready for your thing now? Let me know when I should turn on the karaoke carousel. Look around the room first. The bar is full and buzzing with chatter. No one is paying you any attention, but still you feel your knees turn to noodles. Okay, now a couple is looking at you. Even worse. Physical Instrument says you're sweating. Savoir says, just make sure you move, okay? Don't be stiff. Put your lips against the microphone. Test it. Immediately, a loud feedback noise startles the room. You feel like an amateur. How are you supposed to hold the mic? Should you just sing into it? Where should you stand? Interfacing says, hands, hands. Where do you put your hands? Look, Kim, I'm going to sing karaoke. I can see that. The lieutenant steps away from the stage, ready for your performance. All right. Plus one for throwing in some dance moves, minus one for band conundrum, hand conundrum, and minus one for too close to the mic. I'm ready, Gart. Hit play. Ah, damn. The air is thick with anticipation, Drama says. Failing, though. Which means it isn't. Someone dims the lights as the music starts. A lump in your throat suddenly. I'm gonna pass out. I should have put that stuff away. I'm sitting there with a bag and a multi-tool pry bar thing.
I would often go there.
Oh, God.
To the tiny church there.
His voice was a lot lower than that.
The smallest church in Sansan.
My God.
Now it once was larger. How the real may rest there.
Would it sound better if I hadn't failed with the drama?
Down through the mist there. Towards the seven sisters.
My god, it's so horrible.
Towards those pale cliffs now.
Is that English?
I would often stay there.
That was English.
In the tiny yard there. I have been so glad here. Looking forward to the past here. But now...
God.
You're all alone.
I'm dying.
None of this matters. all.
Oh my god. Oh, is that what he's saying? Limbic system? Thanks, limbic system. I would often go there, this is what he was singing, yeah, to the tiny church there, the smallest church in St. Sains, though it once was larger. How the will may rest there, down through the mist there, toward the seven sisters, toward those pale cliffs there. I would often stay there, in their tiny yard there. I have been so glad here, looking forward to the past here. But now you are alone, none of this matters at all. Whatever the hell. Drama says, do you hear that? It's the most pathetic applause in the world, Harry. Made of pity. No one liked you. Who was clapping? Kim? I didn't see anyone clapping. I'm up here singing my heart out, and it's... good enough? For you? Bleep. You hear or think you hear uncomfortable shifting around. A bit of laughter, maybe? No one's saying anything. Gart says, I'm gonna unplug the mic now, okay? You don't know what good singing is. This is real singing. I sang about real stuff. That's it. I'm unplugging it. He presses top on the tape carousel. Oh, stop, I mean. You hear a little whine of feedback, and then the mic dies in your hand. Interfacing says, that's it. You're unpowered. Let's go, officer. The lieutenant closes his notes. These people wouldn't know a good performance if it bit them in the ass. You liked it? Detective Dubois, he bows lightly. It was downright tragic. Now let's go. Esprit de Corps says, I mean it, he thinks. Tragic mean the song was tragic and I embodied the song? Or the singing was just completely tragic because it was horrible? Conceptualization says, to him, being a cop in the RCM was truly expressed in that performance. Really? All right. Well, we did it. We done did it. We sang the karaoke. It's one of the first things we got. Done. Well, the tape was tragic. Can we go see about this apartment now? Oh wait, we need to talk to these people, right?
Boy, am I ever so grateful to you, officer. But I'm not the only one who wants to thank you.
He nods toward Lena. I'll talk to her then. Morel?
It's great to see you again, officer. My wife can't wait to thank you. Go on, talk to her.
He grins, bowing awkwardly. Lena?
Oh, sweetie. I don't even know how to thank you for finding my husband and helping him out. I hope we haven't been too much trouble for you.
I was just on my way while I was working the case. Here, I want to give you a small token of my gratitude. She hands you a thin ribbon held together by a silver bird skull. It's a tie, mesk in origin. The pin is an antique, quite special. The pin. Is the pin the thing we took from her that we were going to sell and then we just gave it back to her anyway? The little silvery knob holding the tie together feels warm in your hand. It's in the shape of an avian skull with 8 eyes. Encyclopedia says you could ask her about this when you get the time. It's probably a cryptid, but the phasmid, of course, is more important. You never told me you've seen the phasmid. Oh, you don't want to hear about some old woman's ramblings. Ramblings, Morel says. Nonsense. Your description of the phasmid is the most precise I've ever heard. But, darling, I didn't even get the size of it right. You were a child, my dear. Really, it's extraordinary what you were able to describe. Now go on, tell our friend about it. He's proven his interest in the field. Reflexively, the lieutenant readies his familiar notebook. Well, it was summer, she starts. I was building a racing track out of sand on the beach near a tall stand of reeds. Quite a tall one, many times my height, I remember, when all of a sudden... Wait, where was this and how old were you? Ah, I'm getting a hold of my... I'm getting ahead of myself. I was 5 1/2 in Betancourt, in the suburbs. My grandmother had a summer home there. Empathy says she just started forming memories. Real memories, not the billowy haze of infanthood. Encyclopedia says Betancourt got bombed in the war. It used to be quite near. CA 20 kilometers from here. What happened? The strangest moment of my life, I looked up and one of the reeds moved. Not like a plant, but like a living thing. It stood up and looked at me. Its body unfolded like some antique toy. I've never seen anything like it. I don't know. I didn't know this can happen, so I reached my arm and touched the thing. It felt just like a stalk of reed, but it moved, swaying, towering above me. She looks at you. After a while, 20 seconds, a minute maybe, it left. Went into the reeds. Did you follow it? I tried, but I was only a child. There was mud and high water. I couldn't see it anymore. I was just standing there, knee-deep in mud, looking around me. Then what? I ran back home to my grandmother and asked her if reeds could walk and told her they were looking at me. She chuckles. Of course, she just laughed at me. But I knew what I'd seen. For years, it was a story I told at parties, when I wanted to impress boys, that sort of thing. She brushes her hair back. Of course, most people took it as a strange, amusing anecdote. So did I, honestly. But then I met Morel. Morel says, we were on a date, can you imagine? She tells me a story, and it's the most detailed report of the Insulinian phasmid I've ever heard. The sounds, she told me it hissed. It did, yes. Like reeds in a gust of wind. Morel says, the way it moved, the color, how some of its limbs were white like marble. He breathes excitedly. It matched perfectly with what I know from other accounts. It was amazing. If it weren't for Lena, I might have given up hope years ago. It's no exaggeration to say that she restored my faith in my profession. He looks at her with admiration, forgetting a wide smile on his face. You were on a date? Our first, yes. The old woman looks at her husband tenderly. Drama says, the glance is tender, yes, but tempered by something else. A thought she can't even express. She can't express even to him. Interesting. Its limbs are white? Not all of them, he answers for her. There is some white coloration reported, along with beige, where the camouflage ends. How big was it? It's hard to say how big things are when you're quite small yourself. To me, it seemed to be taller than I was then, but that's probably not the case. Maybe you imagined it, Lena? How could she? Who imagines this? She didn't know about the phasmid. This is the main thing here, what makes it a confirmed sighting. She had no previous knowledge of the insect. Logic says, so she couldn't have made it up, or imagined it. Unless it was a coincidence. That's true, yes. I'm almost certain neither my mother nor my grandmother knew of it. It was only when I started telling my story as a teenager that boys would tell me, Lena... She lowers her voice, imitating a boy. You're trying to tell me you saw the Insulinian phasmid out there on those reeds? Get out of here. She smiles. They just give me a cider and ruffle my hair and tell me to stop dreaming. But I saw it. Kim, what do you think of this? I thought it was a wonderful story, ma'am. He closes his notes and gives her a simple smile. Esprit de Corps says, but I don't believe it. A child left unattended on a warm day. Children make up stories and then end up believing them. Thank you for sharing this with me. You're welcome, sweetie. I do appreciate the chance to relive it whenever I get one. It was just such an impossibly sunshiny day. So warm. Empathy says she could get up and walk right into the reeds on her own, into the mud, anywhere. I'd really like to hear about more cryptids. Kim says, you know, to hell with it. Let's have more cryptids. Of course, officers. She smiles politely. Is there a particular cryptid you two are interested in learning about? Is this bird a cryptid? Pointing to the tie. No. Her eyes narrow. It's the cryptid. Wow, the cryptid. Oh yes, the small silvery skull shines between your fingers. Its beak sharp. Okay, what is this bird? The eight-eyed pteratorn, the largest flying avian ever discovered, with a wingspan of 11.5 meters. It was thought to have gone extinct 3,500 years ago. Some even doubted the fossils were real. A mutation, they said, until... Mutation, the man scoffs. All of evolution is a mutation. Until? Until it was sighted by renowned Gottwaldian explorer and naturalist Uwe Platenkalk in 21. Encyclopedia says this renown seems a bit dubious. Your own catalog comes up completely empty, but, of course, you are not all-knowing. I need to hear about this sighting. It happened on a botanical expedition into the vast and unexplored Uramrayo Canyon in southeast Lilmara. Or Ilmara? Dr. Platenkalk got separated from his group during a sandstorm. Okay, and Uramrayo is the world's largest canyon system, sweetie. It's a barren waste east of the Erg Desert, an ancient riverbed completely dried up. What happened? Alone in the blasted desert heat, the doctor wandered eastward where man hasn't stepped foot in over 1,000 years since the fall of Paracarnassus. There's that word again. He was lost without any navigation equipment and desperately low on water. After a day or two, he noticed a bird high in the noon sky, a great black bird. It seemed gargantuan. Every now and then, the bird would dive down to feed on an animal carcass somewhere on the horizon. But by the time Yui got there, the pteratorn had taken off already, and the carcass was picked clean. This happened many times. He followed it? Yes, or rather, hunting. A bird that big has a lot of blood on it, and he was dying of thirst. For many days, Dr. Platenkalk followed the pteratorn until they reached a great canyon wall, where the bird finally landed to rest. The professor climbed up there with a rock in his hand. He found the bird sleeping with his head tucked under its wing, a great black pile of feathers on the perch, so he approached, slowly squeezing the rock in his fist. Then the pteratorn suddenly looked at him. He could see it had 8 eyes, 4 on either side of its skull, like a spider. And the man couldn't move. He was paralyzed, frozen into place with the rock in his hand. Whatever he did, he could not get closer to the bird. Why? The bird was controlling his mind. It kept him from approaching. He could step back, but every time he stepped forward, paralysis. Yui spent 3 days trying until the bird flew away. It should be N, not end. Hold on, how did he survive to tell the story? The eight-eyed pteratorn was indifferent to him, as long as he didn't get any closer than 2 steps. It even let him feed on some carcasses up there, and the 2 unfertilized eggs it left behind. An eight-eyed, mind-controlling bird? Come on. Yes way, sweetie. I didn't say no way. That's the no way answer. She smiles, used to derision. Cryptozoologists have been tracing it ever since, but Uramrayo is vast, mysterious, and holds many secrets. Morel says, modern radar telemetry shows great promise. We will confirm this one by the end of the decade, latest. This one I liked. The lieutenant puts down his notes. Not only does it have 8 eyes and is a living fossil and the largest bird ever to live, it also does mind control. Redrick says he's sincere. He likes the audacity of it. So, that was the last anyone saw of it? Sadly, yes. But there are numerous reports of eight-eyed bird skulls from Ilmara. And then there's the striking resemblance to the Perikanassian Imperial Eagle, an ancient heraldic symbol that are hard to pass off as coincidence. The Imperial Eagle, too, had eight eyes. Conceptualization says not really, it's just stylization. The way they drew eyes, it's not a zoological drawing. Morel says very, very hard. This one's very famous, everyone knows it. People will be looking at that tie on you and thinking, that man is into cryptids. She winks. So, what else do you want to know? Should I just play the rest? Or listen to the rest? What's the tiniest cryptid? Cryobacter ketlensis, she answers immediately. A unicellular bacterium that was discovered in one of the northernmost points of Katla on the Boreal Plateau by renowned geologist Caitlin Mijanot some 70 years ago. What's so special about it? The bacterial colony Mijanot found had remained alive while frozen in ice for longer than anyone could reliably estimate, certainly from before recorded history. Mijanot disappeared shortly after injecting herself with the bacteria. What? Injecting herself? She had brought back the study, no doubt in hopes of prolonging her own life. That's my reaction, number one. Preparing for the end times. Wait, she injected herself with it? Yes, the bacteria had survived in the ice since times immemorial. It's not hard to see where she could have gotten the idea. It's actually a little hard to see, Kim looks at her skeptically, but do go on. I don't understand. Why would you prolong your life? Being alive is terrible. Oh, sweetie, it's not all quite so awful, but prolonging one's life does seem to come with risks. After Mijanot herself with the bacteria, she stopped aging, but also became increasingly eccentric and irascible, so that even her oldest friends were forced to pull away. We can assume that she has been living somewhere in the wilderness for decades now, all alone except for the Cryobacter ketlensis coursing through her bloodstream. You mean there is an immortal geologist wandering the world? Yes, and she's quite mad, too. After she treated herself with the bacteria, she stopped aging. Same answer. I have a few other things I want to choose. She's preparing for the end times. She wanted to witness and record the twilight proceedings. Mijanot did talk about the end of the world a great deal before her abrupt departure. Everyone thought the bacteria had driven her mad, but she really was a brilliant woman. Maybe the Cryobacter ketlensis allowed her to see something no one else could. Okay, what's the most dangerous cryptid? The Gnome of Jeroma. She pauses for effect. The Gnome of Jeroma. That doesn't sound too bad. Oh, it is. None of its victims survived. Grieving relatives never even found their bodies because the gnome's venom dissolved organic tissue. What did this cryptid look like? It was reportedly a small creature with webbed fingers and protruding forehead, an ungainly little thing, quite scary to look at. A couple of campers found it when it was already dying. They heard an odd wailing in the woods and followed the sound. They were scared and wrapped it in tarpaulin to suffocate it. She looks at you, her face grave suddenly. It still took the Gnome of Jeroma an entire day to die. If the body of the creature was found, the lieutenant can't help himself, why aren't there detailed illustrations of it in science textbooks, confirming the existence of this very lethal species? Alas, the first scientist who got his hand on the creature's corpse put it in a jar of formaldehyde, thinking that would detoxify the gnome's venom. Instead, all the venom leaked out of the creature's teeth and into the surrounding liquid, dissolving the creature itself. A poetic end, perhaps, but a real loss for science. she says, mostly to herself. Logic says, alas, always alas, and then it was gone. Isn't that overly convenient? Seems very convenient that it was just disappeared, nothing like it was seen again. She nods. I understand your skepticism, but that's what happens with things that are rare and stand out. Their disappearance is most memorable, and they are least likely to be found again. Okay, and finally, is that a cryptid on this pen you gave me? Yes, it's the kind green ape. Half war story, half undiscovered species in the genus Homo. War story? Yes, it was reported by soldiers in South Sephray during the war. The kind green ape would visit bunkers during the night, healing wounded soldiers with its saliva. Wow, with its saliva? Yes, it has amazing healing qualities. Some soldiers reported growing back limbs, regaining their sight. And there was something about an undiscovered subspecies of man? Indeed, there is. It's our closest relative among the cryptids. Same taxonomic family, different genus. Which is to say, the kind green ape is a species with which we share a common ancestor and that evolved parallel to our own, just like your partners. I knew it, Kim. You're not human. He gives Lena a look communicating something between disgust and exasperation. Ma'am, you're confusing him. I was just kidding. Please don't misunderstand me, either of you. Human, as it is used in everyday speech, is hardly a taxonomic category. For all intents and purposes, you can be thought of as human. She looks at the lieutenant genially. Those zeolites do have some distinguishing characteristics, different advantages, if you will. Kim says, yes, advantages such as the flakier texture of zeolite earwax. Oh, so I've heard. Nothing inspires pride in one species quite like the speculative evolutionary biology. Perhaps we've had enough of that for today? Man, I just can't get enough of these cryptids. She grins. I'm glad you like them, but I'm not really one to tell you about all of them. You should ask my husband if you get the chance. He's the real expert. You don't have more to tell me right now, do you?
Haha! Nothing like the gratitude of a good woman. Now then, what can I do for you?
He gives you a gruff pat on the shoulder. He tries to play it cool, remain professional, professorial, but inside this man is itching for some news on those traps. So I checked all the traps. Good, okay. He breaks his calm, and? And one of them was empty. Completely empty? His eyes grow wide. Yes, there was nothing in a trap. No locusts, no phasmid. No locusts, Lena says, but no phasmid either. That's not ideal, but... He rubs his chin. The old woman's face lights up. It just means the Insulindian phasmid is even more clever than we thought. Rhetoric says she's engaging in a well-known self-deception called motivated reasoning. You should correct them. Kim says, of course, the detective whispers to himself. More clever. Morel says, yes, the Phantasmodea picked off the locust and escaped. This is good news, although we'll have to reconsider the design of the traps, make them more secure. Motivated reasoning. His companion sighs. Gary says, another trip to the reeds. It's not very scientific to reason backward from a conclusion you want to be true. Humph. I appreciate your concern, officer, but please leave this to the experts, unless you have an alternative hypothesis you'd like to venture. Actually, no. His tone changes. Excuse me for getting emotional. This is a big deal for us. You've helped us twice now, and brought some great news, too. My gratitude, and the gratitude of the Societe Cryptozoologique... De Revachol is yours. Inland Empire says, heartfelt gratitude, but does it feel like closure? What really happened? Savoir Faire says, some kind of foul play might be afoot. Theft? Thank you. It's an honor, Kim says with a straight face, then turns to you. We should probably return to our main investigation here. This has been refreshing, but Esprit de Corps says helping cryptozoologists isn't really a priority for our organization, is it? The lieutenant looks out the window impatiently. Conceptualization says, damn it, Lieutenant, have you no intellectual curiosity? Alright. Let's try to... Oh, I insulted morale. I got minus one. Kuno's a hooligan? Helps with this? What does that have to do with anything? Develop an alternative theory about the missing locusts. Success. Consider the way the empty trap was disturbed, interfacing says, as though shaken. Most likely the hands of a young person. Hands small enough to fit inside the trap, too. Oh, we think it was Kuno, then. That makes sense, then. Logic says, you should ask the red-headed boy, Kuno. I think a little hooligan called Kuno may have stolen the locust. He did say something about that, didn't he? Like, way, way back. A little hooligan, Morale says, but what would a child want with bugs? A shadow of worry passes over the woman's face. Oh, my dear Morale, you've been an old man for too long. Kids love to torment insects, almost as much as they love to torment old folks. I'll talk to the little gremlin and see if anything comes up. Delinquents, my favorite, Kim says. It doesn't sound like it's really his favorite. Oh, you've been such a dear to us. Please let us know whatever you turn up. I have a feeling we're getting so close. Gary turns to his companions. Well, I see you've got all the help you need. I'll see you tonight at my place. Let's play suzerainty. But no more field trips for me. Authority says, this is a slippery one. He may respect the law, but mostly wants to pass under the radar. You won't get a chance to talk after you walk out of here. Drama says, he hasn't been particularly forthcoming before. He may well still be hiding something. After he's left, it's too late. So we gotta talk to him now. We can't go. Lena says, really, Gary? The woman's voice is a little shaky suddenly. We're getting somewhere here. I'd love to play suzerainty, but... Lena, I'm sorry, but you're not getting anywhere. It was some kids. I know the little mutants around here. Leave everything out in the open and they'll steal it, even if it's bugs. He looks at his tea. Morale, it's been fun, really, but I need a bath and I have deliveries to handle. When this tea is done, I gotta run. No need to apologize, Gary. You've been more than helpful. We'll have to take a rain check on that game of suzerainty today, though. We're gonna follow this through. Alright, let's talk to Gary. This is Gary? Yeah.